What's up, guys? Thank you for joining us on the Three Life Online Worship Experience. We're so excited to have you. Please join us in worship. No, I can't do it.
Just act a fool. Have fun with it. Like if you're on the moon, or if you're on the moon, or under your bed, or
whether you're in the Middle East or here with us in Trapp County.
Good morning, guys, and happy Sunday. We're so glad to be gathered here in the barn. I'm so glad. Okay.
What's up, guys? Thank you so much for joining us online with Three Life. We are so excited to have you, whether you're all the way up in Toronto or right here in Trapp County. Please join us in worship today. No.
Good morning, guys, and happy.
Wait, hold on. I wasn't ready.
Oh, my God. All
right, now I'm ready.
That was gonna be
sick. I made a face, though.
You're smiling.
I made a face.
That's fine. It's fine.
It's fine.
Okay.
All right, last one. Here we go.
Good morning.
Hey. Good morning, Three Lions. How about that?
Yeah, here we go.
What's up, guys? Happy Sunday, and we're here in the barn. We're ready to worship together with you. I'm Drew.
I'm Terry.
Terry's about to bless us with some amazing songs. You may know them, you may not, but wherever you are, get ready to worship with us. It's going to be an amazing day.
I'm kidding.
Good morning, it's Terry time.
All right, here we go.
You will stay true, even when the lies come. Your word remains true, even when my thoughts don't align. I will stand tall on each promise you made. Far beyond understanding, may it ever set my heart at ease. Dear anxiety, come, I remember that peace is a promise you keep. Peace is a promise you keep. You will stay true. Standing, let it flow in my mind. the presence of Jesus, the keeper of peace. And peace is a promise he keeps.
Hey church, happy Sunday. It's Memorial Day weekend, and before we get into the rest of today's experience, we want to just let you know a little something. Today is Pullover Sunday. If you are a family in need of groceries or know someone in need of groceries, today at 2 o'clock, we will be having our Pullover Outreach food ministry. You'll be able just to drive through and get a bag of groceries for your family. We just want to say thank you so much for your continued support, generosity, church family. We love you so much, and we could not do this without you. If you want to partner with us financially, you can do that now. You could do that after the experience at threelifechurch.com/give. Because of you, we are able to bring this right in your home, and we're able to help and feed our community every single week. During this time, and this weekend is a special weekend, today we are remembering those who have fallen fighting for our country and for our freedom. So why don't you just drop a name in the comments if you know someone that you are remembering today? Why don't you just drop their name in? We want to honor them and remember them today. We are so thankful for everyone who has gone before us, who has fought for our freedom. We're wishing you all a very happy Memorial Day weekend with your friends and your loved ones. We love you. Continue watching this experience.
See you.
Hey guys, so welcome to week 10 of the online services, and I'm looking forward to in the future. I believe in the future we're going to be coming back together, and all you have to do is stay tuned. We're going to let you know what that looks like. But I just want to say on this Memorial Day, a big thank you for those that have served, that you gave your life, those families who know somebody in your family that served our country, gave your life so we could have this kind of freedom. I want you to do me a favor, and I want you just to go into the comments and put an American flag or a heart or smash some hearts right now. All the people that are on the front line, those that are serving actively right now, so we're free to do this. Are you kidding me? It's a massive thank you. Thank you so much. Very much. Let's just take some time and let's just put our hands together or press some hearts right there in your living room and just show some love for those that who sacrificed so much so we could have freedom, right? And I think it was last week is the first time. Now, I have heard people complain about preachers preaching too long, but never in my life have somebody complained for me preaching too short. What you talking about? Are you talking? So today I'm going to preach for the next 3 hours and let's see, 21 minutes, a sermon in John chapter 11. It's not going to be that long. So I just want you to gather around John chapter 11. Okay. We're talking about the story of Lazarus. We're going to jump right in. And here's the title from the front of the message all the way through. Don't freak out. Have faith. I need you to tell three people around you. Don't freak out. Just have faith. I need you to tell your soul right now, don't freak out, just have faith. I need to tell your spirit, your situation. I need to tell your finances, don't freak out, just have faith. I need you to tell your walk with Christ, don't you freak out, just have faith. Now let's read the scripture. It says it like this. A certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary, her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sisters sent to him saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. When you pray, that's exactly how you pray. It's not based on my great love for God. It's saying, God, hey, the one right here that you love needs some help. That's exactly how you should pray. That's exactly how you should live your life. God, the one that you love, and I'm pleading based off of your great love, your great compassion. You said there's no condemnation in Christ Jesus. So because of that, I come to you and I'm pleading the blood of Jesus Christ over my situation. And this is what happened when Jesus heard that. He said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God. I want you to hear that. Watch this. It's not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of Man may be glorified through it. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. It says he loved him, so he stayed 2 more days. Like, he loved him, so he stayed 2 more days. And sometimes God is saying, I love you so much, I'm going to leave you alone right now. I'm going to leave you in your thoughts. Sometimes he's saying, you can't handle what I've got to say right now. So I'm going to leave you alone for a second to where you can get yourself together, because I know you're freaked out right now, but he's speaking to you spiritually speaking, not in the flesh, because our flesh is weak, okay? He's saying in the spirit, I'm waiting till you get ready, okay? And this is what he says. He says, I'm about to remove all rationale, all reasoning. It's not going to be science that gets credit for this. It's not going to be another man that gets credit. I'm about to prove my power. It's not going to make sense on a medical level. It's not going to make sense, but I'm about to prove my power. And what I felt in my spirit is God is saying to us as the church, I'm about to prove my power. It's not going to make sense on the medical term. It's not going to make sense in 10 years from now. I'm about to show you my resurrection power. Same thing that happened to Lazarus's life is getting spiritually ready to happen to your life. And God's about to release a blessing over our homes. Watch this. Not in the flesh, in the spirit, man. There's a joy unspeakable, full of glory. There's peace that passes all understanding. And we know that, but do you know that? Watch this. So what he's saying is not now, not now. He said, look, he stayed 2 more days, right? He said, not now, but not now does not mean never. I want it done right now. I want you to fix my marriage right now. I want you to fix my wife or fix my husband or fix my kids, fix my problem, fix my finances. I need you to fix it right now, Jesus. I ain't got time to wait. And Jesus stays there 2 more days. Lazarus is dead. I need you right now. I don't need you tomorrow. I needed you yesterday. I need you to fix my problem right now. But the problem with that is this. If all you want is your problems fixed, then Jesus is saying, hey, I'm not just here to fix your problems. I'm here for the person. I'm here for your spirit. Because sometimes if we get our problems fixed, we would be like, all right, appreciate you. God would never see us again. That's all we wanted. All I wanted was my relationship. And God gives you the relationship, and then you left church. Or I just needed my financial, or I needed my business fixed. And then God never heard from you again. God is after your heart, not just healing, not just bringing something on the physical. What he's saying is this: just because God doesn't fix it right now does not mean it's never gonna happen. Like when we were kids, even my kids do this. I wanted it right now. And when my parents wouldn't let me have it, I'd be like, I'm never gonna get that. I remember complaining as a kid. I wanted to ride in the front seat. I thought I was big enough. Mom said, not now. You're not big enough. And I was like, I'm never gonna ride in the front seat. Well, now I drive in the front seat. What I thought would never happen. A delay is not a dead end. It's not God denying you. It is simply God saying, hey, I'm about to show you to trust. He's teaching you to trust his timing. God always has a plan. Watch this. He always has a plan. Trust his timing. I need you to work right now. I don't want to wait on you. So what happens is Jesus says, we're going to Judea, okay? Tells his disciples, they freak out. They're like, they're going to try to kill us there. You remember last time? Hello. They're going to try to stone us. And Jesus said this. He said, no, our friend Lazarus, he's asleep, and I'm going to go wake him up. They're like, well, if he's asleep, then he'll just wake up. And Jesus goes, no, Lazarus is dead. Watch this. And then he says, and I am glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. He said, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad. That's where Jesus, if I'm Jesus's PR person, I'm like, okay, chill. You know what I'm saying? Jesus, that was a little harsh. He's dead, and you're glad? That doesn't make sense. And so Thomas is like, great, we're on a suicide mission. This is what Thomas says. He goes, let us also go that we may die. He's that one dramatic friend that takes it way too far. But then Jesus comes into Bethany, and Martha comes to meet Jesus. And this is what was said, and I'm about to preach. So watch this. She said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died, but even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Listen, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Now watch what Martha says. She said, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. And she gives a real spiritual answer that she really didn't believe. What she said, let me make it modern day terms. God is good all the time, all the time. God is good. We have the picture frame, we have the coffee mug, but she didn't really believe it. How do you know that, Pastor Josh? We'll just keep on reading. As you go, when Jesus goes to the tomb, says, roll the stone away. This is what Martha said. She goes, Lord, by this time, there is a stench, for he's been dead for 4 days. She didn't believe it. She was just saying what she was supposed to say. And every single one of us have had those moments where we're like, oh, but I know God's gonna work it out. I know God's in control. But our spirit needs to be reminded sometimes, this is Jesus that we're talking about, and this is what he did with her doubt, knowing that she didn't really believe what she was saying. I am so grateful that Jesus is okay with my doubt. I'm so glad that he loves me through my unbelief, that he's patient with all of my problems, that he's even my freakouts. Preaching to you today and then freaking out on Monday. You know what I'm saying? Where I'm like, you need to have faith. You need to trust God. And then in areas of my own life as a pastor, ain't no other pastor going to tell you, but we're over there saying, I'm doubting how we're going to pay for this. How we're going to do that? All faith on Sunday, where I'm like, you're going to change the world. And then on Tuesday night, I'm like, I can't even change my mind. I can't even change my kids, right? It's that moment where God is reminding us to trust. No, freak out. Have faith. My kids were gone. I think it was last week. They were going to the beach. And on the way home, I'm cleaning up the house, getting everything ready. And so I put the dogs in their little cage. We've got, now we got three of them. We got Zoe, we got Biscuit, we got Bella. Watch this. So I put them in their little thing they got, their little pen they got downstairs. And I go downstairs. I was FaceTiming my kids because they're on their way home. And I got my kids on FaceTime. They're like, let's see Biscuit and Bella. Both of them are Yorkies. And so we go down there, and I'm showing them the dogs. And I look down at Bella, and she's choking. She's like gagging. And I'm like, oh Lord, I dropped the phone and I'm like trying to pull the thing out. I thought it was Violet's watch that was in her throat. And I'm like trying to yank it out of her throat. She starts peeing on me on the floor. And now I'm freaking out and my kids are freaking out because they think our dogs are dying. And I'm like, they can't die on FaceTime. I'm clicking off of it. I call the vet. I throw Violet into the car or Bella into the car. I'm headed to the vet. I call him. I'm like, my dog's choking. She's choking to death. I'm freaked out. And so I'm like, this, she can't die on my watch. So I go in there and I'm waiting in the parking lot. The place is packed. And I'm calling the people. They're like, sir, somebody's going to be out here shortly. And they didn't come out quick enough. And so I'm out there. I'm that person. I'm that, like, that freak out mom. I'm over there looking at the mirror, looking through the window like this. Like, I know y'all can see me. You better come in here because I'm about to open up the door and bust up in all of these distancing policies. I'm about to come up in here. And I'm totally freaked out. Get back in my car. And finally, they sent somebody out. And the lady comes up to me, and I'm like, she's dying. She's choking. And she looks at my dog. She's like, and she does this. And she clicks this little thing. Just clicks a little button. And when she clicked it, I thought it was Violet's watch that she was choking on. It was her collar, okay? And I'm looking at this lady like, I knew that. I knew it was her collar the whole time. I'll just make sure y'all are professional. I tried to trick you. I tried to get you. And I felt so dumb. I was like, how in the world did I not check to see? She's choking on her own collar. It's not a watch. I thought it's like down in her throat where she's dying. But all this lady, all she had to do was unbuckle it. And that's exactly what Jesus wanted me to remind you. To quit choking on things that all you had to do is just, all she had to do is click a little button. It was just like this. She just goes, there you go, there you go. And she just got it off. And she looked at me and I felt so stupid. But how many of us are choking on things where you're one click away from that problem being gone? Sometimes you gotta click the unfollow button and quit choking on what they're posting about. Sometimes you gotta click the TV off and open up the word in your home. Sometimes you gotta, you ain't Dorothy, quit trying to click your heels together and commit to God. It's spiritually speaking. I don't understand how I'm gonna get through this. I don't know how I'm going to, but I've got a God that can, if he can separate the waters from Moses and them, if he can call down fire from heaven through Elijah, if he can raise Lazarus from the dead, if he can do this kind of thing for them, he can do it for me. She didn't freak out. She fixed it. And that's what God has called it and said through Jesus. He didn't freak out when sin entered the world. He fixed it. He put on flesh and he bore all of our shame. And what I did that day, God reminded me, he said, quit calling an ambulance when an aspirin is all you need. Sometimes you just need a nap. Sometimes you just need to eat. Sometimes you just need to get back to the basics and get in God's word and trust him. I'm freaking out that day. And it was one click away. I'm talking about one click away. You are one click away from not just liking a post, but from committing to God with everything that you've got to say, I'm not baby faith. I'm not over here I'm jumping in the deep end with God. I'm gonna commit my marriage. I'm gonna commit my relationship. I'm gonna commit my college degree. I'm gonna commit my career. I'm not just gonna sit here and click that I love God. I'm gonna commit with my life and say, hey, I don't know how you're gonna do it, but I believe you can. This is exactly what he was showing us. Jesus didn't freak out because he had a plan. Now Mary comes to him, and this is what Martha just freaked out. If you'd have just been here, he wouldn't have died. And guess what happens? Then Mary came to Jesus. She saw him. She fell down on her feet. Lord, if you'd have just been here, my brother would not have died. And Jesus says this. Pay attention, because we got a couple of minutes together, okay? Pay attention. Watch this. This is what he asked. He said, where have you laid him? Okay? They said, Lord, come and see. Jesus, then he wept, and the Jews said, oh, look how much he loved him. And then Jesus told him, he said, hey, I want you to remove the stone, okay? Martha, the sister of the one who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there's a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days. Most believed back in the day that the spirit would hover for a couple of days. But after the fourth day, the body would begin to decompose. Now family would be mourning. And it was beyond all hope after 4 days. It was beyond all resurrection. It was beyond all belief that anybody could come back from this moment. And he says to her, he said, Did I not say that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? The dead man was lying. And as Jesus lifted up his eyes, he prayed to God. And he looks at the tomb and he says, Lazarus, come forth. And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes. And his face was wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, loosen and let him go. But he asked this question, and I want to ask it to you. Where have you laid him? Where have you laid him? Take me to the place where hope died. Take me to the place where the doubt started. Take me to the place where fear consumed you. Take me to the place where you lost your joy. Then he said, remove the stone. In other words, he's saying, open up to me. Tell me about what hurt you. Take me to that past relationship where you got, he said, I want you to be honest. Some of you are mad at God. And he said, you can be honest with me. Take me to the place where you lost your joy. Take me to the place where you lost your shout. Take me to the place where you were hurt the deepest. Be honest with me. He said, remove the stone. I want to bring some healing into your life. But take me to the place. Take me to the place where doubt and fear destroyed your heart. Take me to that place and let me heal you. Take me to the place where you got angry and bitter, where jealousy started raging inside of your soul. And then when you take him to that place, he says, he looks at you and he says, Lazarus, he says, Josh, come forth. He calls you in the spirit to come out. He's not saying just in your flesh. He's saying, I've got a life for you. It's full of joy, but he calls you personally. He calls you by name. Quit thinking about your neighbor, your wife, your husband, or your future. Leave it in the past. He said, quit bringing up what happened back there. He's calling you out of darkness into his light, but he calls you by name. It's so personal that he loves you. And he says, hey, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you. I want you to say your name right there. Say, hey, Josh, come forth. Hey, Drew, come forth. Hey, Annalisa, come forth. You're sitting there on your couch. God is talking to you. He's saying, come forth. It was this week that most of you, maybe you know, maybe you don't know, but I speak at Kia. And I speak at the store here in town and on Tuesdays. And then on Thursdays, I speak in Tallahassee, which is in Alabama, and I speak in Auburn as well. And I show up this past Tuesday, and when I get there, I'm like, where's everybody at? And I get there at 9 o'clock every single week, speak. We're gonna bring some Tuesday motivation, Tuesday talks. It's just, woo, we have a good time, and that's my family, that's my Kia family. But I show up on Tuesday and I'm like, where's everybody at? I go in there. There's not a salesman in there. I call Todd, which is the general manager. I'm like, hey, bro, where's everybody at? He said, Josh, it's 7:58 there, buddy. It's 8 o'clock. And I said, hey, I'm going to have to call you back. Okay. I need to try to figure this out. I get off the phone and I'm like, how in the world did I get here an hour early? Why am I an hour early? What in the world has gone on? Well, what I did is I accidentally hit my Tallahassee alarm, which is, you know, Alabama, it's a different time zone. And so I hit my Thursday alarm and not my Tuesday alarm. And I'm showing up thinking I'm late. I'm like, man, I'm late. And I'm rushing to get there because I'm like, man, why is this morning going by so fast? And I'm thinking that I'm late when really I was ahead. And so many times we are freaked out thinking God is late when in all reality, he's already ahead of you. He's not late. He's actually early. God is already ahead of you. He's in your past. He's in your present. He's in your future. God is not late. I thought I was late when really I was early. You're thinking that God's late. They thought Jesus was late, but he rolled up not just right on time. He was early. He said, watch me. I'm about to prove my power. I'm coming in when all hope is gone. When you can't blame it on or you can't give credit to somebody else in your life, when you can't give credit to anything else, God comes in right on time, and he brings healing before he even, look, watch this. He's so early that when Jesus died and rose again, before they could even make it to the tomb, he had already resurrected. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. This story isn't about Martha. It's not about Mary. It's not about Lazarus. Lazarus was a picture of Jesus coming out of that tomb, right? For every single one of us, they couldn't even get to the tomb early enough. Jesus had already left that thing. Why? Because he has gone ahead of you. He knows what your tomorrow looks like, so stop worrying about that. He knows what next year looks like, so rest in the fact. He's teaching you to trust his timing. It's not a delay. He hadn't forgot about you. Run that doubt out and begin to praise the Lord in your living room. Begin to give God praise before the problem is fixed, knowing that God is on the way. He's going to get glory out of this. I've watched some people go through a horrible time during this season. I wish I could take that pain away, but the Holy Spirit wants to enter into your life and give you a peace that passes all understanding and give you a joy that you don't read about on Facebook, that you don't read about in any other platform of social media. It's a joy that's on the inside. It's unspeakable. It's full of God's glory for your life. And I'm telling you, I just wanted to ask this question that God put inside of my heart. He's running this stuff out of our lives. But what he's saying is this: what is God trying to unbuckle in your life? What's he trying to free you from? What have you been choking on? What have you been sitting there going year after year? Maybe it's for a decade, been choking over the same thing. You know the spiritual answer, and you, hey, are you saved? Yeah, I asked Jesus to come into my heart, and but there's been no change. I'm talking about, has there been change, a life change? Has this resurrection life came in and saturated your soul and your spirit come alive where you're like, man, I don't want to just play a Christian game. My goodness, run guilt out of my life. God, I want to be a living example. Like Lazarus, people came just to see him and they believed in Jesus because of Lazarus' story. Lazarus didn't even have to say nothing. Lazarus, they just looked at this dead man who was dead. That's what the gospel does. It takes those that were dead and brings life. Actual life, right? But I'm challenging you today, instead of choking on it, take him to the tomb. Take him to the place where you got mad. Take him to the place from your past that you won't talk to nobody about. Take him to the pain that you've tried to hide. And don't freak out. Let him fix it. And when he does, he'll give you a faith where you can run just like Lazarus, just like Martha, just like Mary, and point to Jesus, not at some curriculum, not at some church, not at some pastor, not at some person, where you point to Jesus and say, whew, that's the one that came into my life and said, I can fix that. Holy Spirit, we love you so much. And I'm so grateful for the joy that we find in realizing you are the resurrection. You are our life. And I'm grateful, God, for this moment. I'm grateful, God, that I don't have to freak out, Lord. I can just have faith and you give it to me. We can have faith and you give it to us. So, Lord, I pray that we would be bright lights in this city, wherever we go, and we would trust your plan. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. So for the rest of this week, my challenge is this. Don't freak out. Just have faith. But if you've never trusted Jesus, it's this simple. It's saying, God, all right, I surrender. I'm giving you my life. I'm asking you, if he's working on your heart right now, you're saying, I want to leave this life of sin. It hasn't satisfied me. I'm so sick and tired of just living for my own pleasure. Jesus, I need you in my life. Jesus, with arms wide open, says, hey, do you believe me? Do you believe that that's why I came? If you do, you don't have to behave better. It's just simply believing. And when you believe right, guess what? Your behavior will follow. Just ask him right now from your heart to heaven. Say, Lord, come into my life and save me. God, I ask you to forgive me of my sin. But Lord, right now I make a commitment to you that if you'll forgive me and I receive that forgiveness, I'll live my life for you. Thank you for saving me. I turn from my sin and I'm trusting your righteousness, not mine. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, church. If you've enjoyed today's message and you're believing God for faith for the future, I want you to throw some hearts out there and put some amens in the comments, and I'll see you again next week.
Well, that's a wrap. Thanks so much, church, for tuning in today from wherever you are. Give this message and this experience a share with your friends. and we want to make sure you tune back in with us next week. Be sure to stay up with us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, and be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're going to be back in the barn soon, and we want you there with us. So stay up with us each and every day on social media to let you know what's coming up next. We love you. Thanks for watching. Have an amazing week, church.